You are now listening to The Project.
To The Project.
To The Project. Where we stop at nothing to bring you the right facts on health, fitness, and psychology. Featuring some of the world's most experienced professionals. So you can learn, lift, and live. With your hosts, Mank, Dr. D, and Mehdi.
Why care? I mean, let's be realistic. If people find you offensive, you know, they shouldn't follow you anyways or talk to you anyway. People can't relate to you and, you know, and enjoy the value that you bring to their life, whether it's through laughter or anything or just being silly. You know, like, we forget about being silly, you know, when we were kids. Think of how much fun you had as a child. Now it's kind of like stifled by being an adult.
I still remember one time you came into my office trying to explain to you why I graded you on this homework. He harassed me. Why did you do this? Why he was harassing me? I was like, can I just give this guy a grade just to get him off my back? I said, no, you did not do a good job. No, you didn't follow these rules. And you're like, but I did. I tried, Dr. D. Doesn't that mean something to you? I said, no, it doesn't.
There's so much social media. There is online dating. We're so quick to just immediately, you know, swipe left, swipe right. Like, we're making immediate decisions all the time that sometimes I think the second something negative happens, and this is probably in all of our relationships, you know, you think the worst. So it's like, instead of like giving a second chance, I think a lot of us just go, not worth my time, just gonna, you know, not think about it anymore. Where it's like, in reality, those people could actually be really great people. And it's just like, because you took their tone wrong or they said a sentence a certain way, you immediately are like, oh, like, I'm not gonna go there.
Okay, so the first time we actually like met was at the coffee shop to record our first podcast. Like, there had been some text conversation, you know, like before that, but I walked in and I was like, oh, that's Maddie. I had seen you at the Borough working out before, and you always had your piece of paper, your program, whatever you're doing. But I just remember thinking, like, this guy, like, knows what he's doing.
All this and more in today's episode.
All right. Whole group's here today, Meg, and we're all relying on you for the instructions.
All right. Okay, so we're not really strangers is the name of the game. And I'm excited because Danica and Dr. D, this is your guys' first time recording together and meeting. So this will be fun.
But
if you haven't seen them, they have a really cool Instagram account and they just ask really like meaningful questions that lead to some good, fun conversation. So there's a really cool video on YouTube. If you look it up, they set this up in a park in California and two random people will come and sit down, and there's three levels to this game. So you get cards that you pick from. So level one is all about your perception. So it'll ask questions of basically like what you're perceiving about this other person. Level two is connection. So questions that dig just a little bit deeper into who each person is. And then in level three is reflection. And it's a really heartwarming video. It's awesome to watch. But I play this with a lot of my coaching groups that I do just to kind of break the ice with people. And it's brought up a lot of like funny conversations and just interesting bits, even to play with people that like you've known for a long time. Right now, they've been marketing it as helping people get through their breakups, which Dr. D, I think, was kind of like a psychology thing that like maybe look at dealing with relationship advice with this game, getting people to open up about things.
That's a nice one. Wow.
You know, there's like board game for adults too, supposed to like dig deeper, but like the questions they ask are very, I don't know, like I know groups of people who played that. I mean, they were probably drinking at the same time, but they like ended up not speaking to each other for a couple of weeks. It like asks you questions like, okay, choose a person and ask them like why they used you ever or something like that. Like real dark stuff.
It's damn. We're either going to end this like being a lot closer to one another or this is the end of the podcast.
No, we are strangers now.
But they do say there's two ways to play. You can play to be safe. So obviously like withholding information, not being...
Fuck that. Let's go all the way.
Play to grow.
All right.
Go big or go home.
Absolutely. I'm not sure I'm comfortable with this.
I got like 10 degrees hotter in this room right now.
I was like, I know my ears will turn red.
Dr. D, you're probably going to have no clients later.
Yeah, probably. So I have to be like really careful.
How do we want to do this? Do we want to like, I'll ask a question and then we like each answer for someone in in the room here, in the game here, or do we want to answer?
Oh my God, I wish Hay was in on this game, dude.
I know.
She would totally like destroy me.
Probably. We can, oh, what we can do, we'll post the questions on our stories, and it can be Haya's answers for you, Maddie.
Ooh, that's a good one. That's a good one. But I'm banned, so I can't really, you know. Really. Goddamn vegans.
Just can't get over this.
So funny. All right, level one, you ready?
Okay.
And I picked just like a random stack from level one, so I don't know what these questions are ahead of time either, so we're just drawing them randomly here. So first one is, who do you think my celebrity crush is?
Well, that's a good one.
I want to say Roy Gold, but I guess he's not really a celebrity.
Roy Gold is, you guys should look up his Instagram. He is like a movement freak.
Oh my gosh, do I have it up? Maybe I have one of his things up.
And he's gorgeous.
Oh my gosh.
I would say you're more of a Matthew McConaughey person. Like the naked fucking yoga, whatever thing.
Yeah.
That's Roy.
That's, yeah.
That looks like Meg's crush right there.
Right?
Matthew McConaughey for sure. Like I've always had a crush on him. My current celebrity crush is Chris Pratt.
Really? Oh,
I'm obsessed.
Who's Chris Pratt?
He plays Andy in oh my God, Parks and Rec.
Parks and Rec, yeah.
He's also in Jurassic Park.
Oh, okay.
He's in Guardians of the Galaxy. He's
yeah, I know who that is then. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
Guardians of the Galaxy like, got me.
Yeah. Wow. All
right.
I'm not Danica, totally surprised.
Guess Maddie's celebrity crush.
Well, I thought Matthew Wahlberg was already his.
Yeah, Matthew Wahlberg, that's right. Yeah. Or no, Mark Wahlberg. My Matthew.
Mark Wahlberg, yeah.
Mark Wahlberg, yeah.
Whatever. Yeah,
like. That's it right there. That's totally it right there. At 45. Marky Mark, 100%. That guy's my celeb crush.
Oh, all right, Dr. D, what do you think Danica's celebrity crush is? This is hard.
I feel like this is going to be hard.
I don't know, because I don't really know a lot of celebrity, you know? I don't watch a lot of TV, so I don't know.
Hold on, Danica, how old are you, just out of curiosity? Are you around our age?
I'm about to turn 32.
Okay, all right, so you're a little bit younger. I'd say you look like a Justin Bieber, kind of.
You know what? I'm glad you're blocked on social media. You want to know what? I actually have a secret. It's not that secret, but I kind of have a thing for Andy Samberg. I'm not going to lie.
Oh,
I don't know. Yeah,
that fits you.
I do. I have kind of a weird, yeah. I mean, I'm also on the Matthew McConaughey train, but yeah, something about, man, when I watch Brooklyn Nine-Nine, I'm just like, oh. Yeah.
That's awesome. All right.
Well, I'm a lot older than you guys, so none of those would be.
Dr. D, I got my pick already. Meg, I'm interested to see who you say for Dr. D.
For Dr. D, I'll say Kurt Russell.
Ooh, that's a good one. That is a good one.
He's also one of my celebrity crushes.
No, but I like him. That's true. So that is my generation, yeah.
Danica, you're up for Dr. D.
I don't know. How about Clooney? I don't know. I feel like he's like very like, good-looking guy.
Go. Yeah, he is.
He's aged very well.
Before that, with yes, that's right. One more. But right, Maddie, would it. Be. I got mad when he married.
All right, so I'm going with a whack job here just because she's a psychologist and saying Jack Nicholson. All right.
You say who?
The Shining. Jack Nicholson. The Shining. Anger management. Like, he's right up your alley, Dr. D. He's a total nut.
No. Denzel Washington. Is
oh,
right?
Denzel.
Yeah, that's another good one.
That's a good one.
Nice.
That is my guy.
I would even add him to my list, too.
Yeah. He's still handsome. Oh, jeez.
That's awesome. Maddie, who for real is yours? I know Marky Mark, but who else?
Well, for real, I hope Haya doesn't listen to this. She never listens to the show anyway, so that's always a good thing. If anyone, like, honestly, Julia Roberts? Probably, like, she's, I always found her hot, empowering, you know, she was in Pretty Woman, she was in that other movie, Erin Brockovich, I thought she was hot in Erin Brockovich, I thought she was wicked hot in that movie, really empowering, like, solving the case and all that shit,
yeah,
so I'd probably say, like, the Julia Roberts type.
Oh, okay.
I don't really like stars that much, I'm not into them.
I don't like stars either, but you know, I was thinking Jennifer Aniston for you.
Ooh, Jennifer Aniston's, I can't be too loud. But yeah, I would definitely say Jennifer Aniston. Yeah.
You know what's funny is the other day, actually, at the store, Tom Hanks and his wife came in. And I like, oh, I thought I was going to be like so starstruck because I thought about it. Cause I know he has a house here and I'm like, oh my God, if he ever comes in, I'm going to lose my shit. And he came in and I was just like, I just stood in the back and like stared at him. I couldn't say a word. His wife went to buy a bra and he just, we were actually at capacity. We weren't supposed to let him in. And he had a mask on, obviously, so you couldn't tell like who he was. But so one of the girls like tried to kick him out. And then when he talked, she recognized his voice and she was like, okay, you can wait right here.
That's kind of cool though. All
right. Awesome. Next one for perception and then we'll move on to connection. What was your first impression of me?
Salesman. You totally tried to sell me a PT. Like you totally tried to sell me a PT. And I was just like, yeah, I thought like she was going to give me some free advice, but she wants me to book an appointment.
I thought you were smart and articulate.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. I thought you were like full of information. I'm not thought you are. That was my first impression. Like,
yeah.
No, I failed. Oh yeah, you did. No, but I felt like you're really articulate. Like I love articulate people, smart, well-read.
Nice.
I agree with Dr. D. I mean, hence why I reached out to you and said, let's do a show together. You know, like, right, like that was my first impression. I was like, smart, articulate, jam well. You know, you got a lot of the same thought processes in a better way, so to speak. So yeah, I mean, pretty smart, Meg.
Nice.
Thanks. Oh, let's see.
I feel like the first time that I met, well, the first time I was going to meet you, I was abandoned in Kuwait. I was like, wow, these people are awesome. Just left me here by myself.
I had a rough coming to Kuwait experience.
Well, when I was picked up, they send the driver to pick me up that doesn't speak any English at all. So then, and he kept saying that I looked like a male soccer player on top of that. So I just was like, you know very little English, but you know enough to tell me that I look like this guy who's not even a good looking man on top of that. So I was just like, I look like an ugly guy. Thank you. But I'm apparently a great soccer player. I was like, awesome. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, I just thought you were fun. Like we were like always down to like do new things, which I thought was cool. You know, rolling around boxing rings and doing weird animal moves and playing with Jenga blocks. And I don't know, all sorts of fun stuff that we would do.
The movement days.
Weird movement games.
Now you're still in Kuwait?
I'm not. I'm in Seattle now.
Oh, you're in Seattle. Wow.
Yeah.
Beautiful country.
Oh, yeah.
Ever going to come back to Kuwait or have you ex-Kuwait out? I'm curious, like you and Meg, are you guys ever coming back or is it like total like, yeah, it's just not happening. It's not in the cards again.
I would come back to visit like for a while, but I wouldn't move back.
Yeah, I was going to say I would do like a short, like, you know, do like a 3 to 6 month stint, but I don't know that I would stay there permanently again.
Yeah.
Just because, I don't know. Plus I'd want to live somewhere. If I'm going to live abroad again, I think I'd want to live somewhere new just to, you know, have another little check mark on there, you know?
That makes
sense. Why not?
Yeah. Were you in Dubai at all or no?
I wasn't. No.
No. Would you guys move to Dubai if the opportunity presented itself? Just out of curiosity. No, really? Dubai's awesome. Like Dubai's the greatest place on earth.
I would consider it.
It's busy. It's busy and crowded and expensive.
It's the greatest place on earth. It really is.
Just for visiting. I think people that live there are not as happy as you think.
I think so.
I mean, expats.
Bull-fucking. Yeah.
They make rain, dude.
It's very, very expensive. It's very expensive to live there.
They make rain and shit. They make everything there. Like I'd live in Dubai. I want to live in Dubai.
I think that the cool thing about Dubai is there's a lot of opportunities for certain things that you might not get anywhere else just because they have like, you know, a little bit, they're going to push like more of the tech stuff and more of that, like, you know, some of the bigger things that other places aren't willing to do or spend the money on, which is kind of cool. So I think if it was like a good opportunity, not to mention like location's great for traveling. I mean, you got a major airport there. You're pretty much dead center to go either Asia or to the, you know, west, east, whatever direction you want to go in, which is kind of cool. But I feel like I agree. It'd have to be, I don't know, have to be something. I always, when I lived in Kuwait, I actually used to always say, I don't think I would ever live in Dubai. Yeah. I just don't know if
interesting.
I can. Yeah.
No, I would visit, but I don't think so because it's very crowded. I don't want to sit in traffic. It's like Chicago, you know?
Not as much anymore. My cousin and her husband moved there. They thought they were going to be there for a year. They've been there for 4 years and now it's turned into they never want to move back to Kuwait. They're just like, we can do anything here. You know, you have clean parks. You can have the outdoor life. You can have the cheap or the expensive or Dubai's awesome. I love it.
I think it's too expensive. You really got to make a lot of money. And in order for you to enjoy a lot of luxury, you have to spend a lot more.
Yeah, but you can live on a budget. I mean, that just comes down to money management at that point.
It's very hard, I hear. I mean, I don't know. A lot of my friends say it's very hard, especially if you have kids and you want to put them in all these activities.
Yeah.
I guess maybe people are making more money than here, but real estate is expensive. Rent is expensive. I would rather just go and visit and that's it.
Yeah, it makes sense.
You know?
Yeah, after the weekend leave. I'm about the small town now. It'll take a lot of money to get me back into a big city.
Yeah, we'll get you back to Kuwait, Meg. And you too, Danica, at some point. So Danica, you're up next. All right, Meg, you go first.
All right. So Danica, my first impression of you, it was actually over like a Skype interview for the job to come out to Kuwait. And I think just during that, I was just like, the word that comes to mind is just unpredictable. Got so many different like skill sets and things. Just listen to, like, she did Middle Eastern studies. Like, she can read Arabic, but she can't speak it. And she's also just like this tiny, dainty little thing, but then like a super strong motivator, like with people in like boot camp classes. And now she coaches like F45. So I just find Danica like unpredictable. And that's always been like my first impression was just like, what else can she do?
That's hilarious. That's actually close to what someone just said to me recently.
Oh, that's awesome.
That's hilarious.
Dr. D, what do you think of Danica since it's your first time meeting her? I think that's hilarious.
Granted, I just met her. My first impression, which is like build on like 10, 20 minutes.
Do you think she looks like a soccer player? I think that's the first question we all need to ask.
She looks like an athlete. She definitely looks like, my first impression is that she has a lot of energy, you know, and fun. That's the only thing I could think of. She was smiling. She's, you know, energetic. So that's, you know, I felt like, oh, this might be fun because she's laughing and we might laugh together. So that's why.
Yeah. Aw.
Yeah. Wait till we talk about you, Hadi, and your first time.
I'm so going to deflect it and watch it. Wait, wait until you hear what I see or say after I say my first impression of Danica. First off, it was like, who the fuck is stealing my podcast buddy, Meg? All right. That was the first thing. And when Meg was like, yeah, we should podcast together, I'm like, all right, you know what? Yeah, it's on. It's game. It's game. But no. You're pretty cool. I mean, you know, whoever Meg brings to the table, whoever is friends with Meg, like, I always assume they're knowledgeable, smart, funny, athletic, and, you know, all the above. And, you know, you're pretty chill, dude. Pretty awesome.
Chill is usually the word that people use.
You're not a vegan. So are you a vegan? If you're a vegan, like, all the cards are off.
I'm not a vegan. That's apparently my soccer lookalike.
Oh, okay.
He's not a bad looking guy.
What?
He's not like George Clooney
or Brad Pitt of like dudes, though.
I would have to say he doesn't look anything like you, but like, he's still not bad looking.
He was so happy about this that I looked like Luca. And like, it got to the point where all the guys at Circuit Plus started calling me Luca.
Oh my God.
Like, oh, look, it's Luca. I hate all of you right now.
Oh, that's like, hilarious.
Oh, yeah.
It's true. Like,
I got a quick question for Meg and for Danica. What do you think people's first impressions are of you when they meet you? What's your perception of their perception?
I've been told a lot, like intimidating.
Wow.
Intimidating. I've tried to soften on that because like I'm like super aware of that now. And I'm like, oh God, I don't want to be intimidating. I have a first date with somebody on Sunday. I'll ask them.
Oh, that's a good one.
Wow. Ooh. I think people look at me and think that I am like, I can be a bit of a pushover, I think sometimes, or like I have a very like, I don't want to say innocent look, but a very like young. And so a lot of people, sometimes like I'll go places and I feel like they think I'm going to be the super nice one about everything. So it's just, spicy. You know, they don't expect me to kind of have any like firm hand or be like, no, you're not going to like do that. Like, I don't know. It's just kind of funny. They have this.
So you
expect
don't come
me to just kind
assertive.
Of like, yeah, be kind yeah. of like, oh yeah, I'll just let you get away. No. That's not going to happen. But like, I'm nice, but I'm not that nice. Like, let's relax. But yeah.
Small but mighty. She's fierce.
All right, Meg, what do you think of Dr. D?
All right. My first impression of Dr. D, I'm trying to think of like the first time that we like recorded together. I'll be honest. When I first saw a picture, because it was like a very professional picture. Like part of my mind, I was like, I wonder if she's TK or if she's more chicken nugget.
Oh, geez.
The photo looked more like TK, but then like getting to know you, I was like, okay, she's like from Chicago. She's not as TK as I thought.
Jeez.
So, yeah. I thought like, yeah, good personality and down to earth and like more down to earth than what I was like expecting, like based off of a TK profile.
I want to know which picture is that. We're taking it off.
Way to go, Meg. Wow.
Like down to earth. Yeah.
I was going to say my first, well, again, it's same thing. Like it's only been like 20 minutes. So, or 10 minutes, however long it's been. I was going to say it just feels like you have your shit together. You just came in very like, I'm like, in like a, you know, this thing, you're like very well put together. You're like ready. You're like, okay, here I am.
Don't let this fool you. I was taking pictures for Instagram today.
Danica and I are like,
it was my photo day. I'm put together. That's very true. I think my students always, they don't know what time I wake up so I can like get ready. But it's true.
Yeah.
Nice.
Maddie.
Oh my God, I don't even know where to start. This is going back years ago.
It's been like 10 years ago.
No, but in all honesty, I remember the day. I mean, it was intimidating. Like you were very intimidating as a professor, but yet very sweet after class. You're like, oh, you know, if you're still struggling, you should come see me in my, you know, in the student, whatever counseling thing. It was pretty cool. And like that impression was like, oh, you know, Dr. D, she's, you know, not just a professor and a psychologist. I could relate to her. Like you're cool. You're a great professor. I think very relatable for students. But yet you can come down with an iron fist.
I can. I'm definitely not a pushover. Aggressive, more like it.
Oh, that is 100%. That is 100%.
It's true. It's true. And you know, you know, asking like, what do most people think of me? They do think the first thing that comes up is that I look intimidating. You know, guys oftentimes think I'm very intimidating and very outspoken. You know, I could scare, especially guys, like I could really scare them. And I I don't know why I'm intimidating. Maybe because, I don't know why they think that or what do I do? But I'm like you, Meg. I'm like, should I soften it up? But then I, at this age, I'm like, look, I've lived a half a century. I'm not living the next half a century trying to give a shit about them thinking I intimidate them. You know, I mean, of course, I also have a prominent features. I have a long dark hair that also like affects the way people see me. So they think that, you know, and then I'm very confident. And I think a lot of people say that to me, that the first impression they're intimidated until they realize I'm really empathic and I'm nice. And you know,
it is funny to think like the intimidating thing when people say like, oh, you're so like outspoken. And I'm like, really? I feel like I hold back a lot.
Like, you're like, you have no idea.
I don't hold anything after this age. Yes, before. Now I don't care. I just say what I need and what I want. And
what age does that happen at, Dr. D?
Half a century. At least for me, it was a mark. I was like, look, I don't give a shit. So if they thought I was intimidating in my 30s, I wonder what they think now.
What do you guys think of first impressions, though, in reality? Like, do you think first impressions do make or break us? Or do you think we can get past first impressions with people and people getting past it with us? What is your takes? Because we've all had similar roles in HR and, you know, dealing with people, dealing with clients, dealing with athletes and everything. And I would say from an athletic perspective, you know, for me, first impressions are the first practice. And I used to be able to weed out who are the workers, who are the, you know, the kids that cried a lot, who are the kids that, and I'm not talking like kids, I'm talking teenagers that always said, oh, you know, this hurts or whatever. So Meg, you know, what do you guys think of that with the first impressions? Does it break? You know, if someone has a bad first impression, is that, all right, you suck and I'm done. Is it a cutoff right away or do you give a second chance?
I feel like I'm pretty open with second chances. I mean, it depends on what that first offense was, but
I think that makes a difference.
It depends on, I guess, like, how awful the first impression was. But I feel like I'm pretty open-minded. And it's actually funny, like, in thinking about this with like online dating, right? Like, I feel like that makes you very like judgmental. Right, looking at this profile, like they have a spelling error on there or something, you're like, oh, idiot, you know, like, or there's like a picture, you know, that just, I don't know, like something along those lines, I think that makes you, whereas like if you had met that person in real life in any other context or any other scenario, like you probably would be a little bit more like patient with some of those things, or a little more understanding of some of those things, or just have a little bit more insight. So I think like that's probably one thing I got better at with that, is to be like a little bit more open-minded of like, hey, if you're going to meet people, like don't be so judgmental right off the bat. But then that first like in-person meeting was definitely like, you know, and I think in general, like with clients and stuff too, it's kind of the same thing, right? Like there's a, most of the first meetings are, you know, virtually and stuff. So that's why I've switched to like phone calls now. Like I actually get on like a face-to-face Zoom or an actual like phone call with somebody, so I can like hear their voice, hear them speak, like listen to their tone, like listen for some of the energy behind those words, like, you know, try to pick up as much as you can of the personality. I don't know. That's how it's gone for me. But I think I'm pretty open-minded for second chances.
I agree. I think, yeah, I mean, obviously it definitely depends, but I mean, I think the problem we have now is because we're so quick, like you're saying, everything is, there's so much social media, there is online dating. We're so quick to just immediately, you know, swipe left, swipe right. Like we're making immediate decisions all the time that sometimes I think the second something negative happens, and this is probably in all of our relationships, you know, you start to, you think the worst. So it's like, instead of like giving a second chance, I think a lot of us just go, not worth my time, just gonna, you know, not think about it anymore. Where it's like, in reality, those people could actually be really great people. And it's just like, because you took their tone wrong, or they said a sentence a certain way, you immediately are like, oh, like, I'm not gonna go there. It's same thing like when we're going to businesses, you know, you walk into a business, if you walk into a coffee shop, you know, and you're trying a new one, and the service is terrible that day, you might never go back to that coffee shop just from that one experience. You know, it's kind of like we don't give people too many chances. I feel it's a very like, we just want like quick satisfaction. If we don't get it right away, we just move on, which is unfortunate.
You know, I think being a psychologist, I've learned a lot not to, you know, have, because can you imagine how many people would not have given me a chance because they thought I was intimidating? Mm-hmm. So for me, I just understand that perception has a lot to do with our experience. And usually I tell my students that, is that because everyone has his own perception, and there are a lot of people like, you know, they just rub you off the wrong way, but you don't really know why. I mean, of course, I think we'll be very naive to think that first impression doesn't matter. It does matter. And I think people do, because we want to protect ourselves and because we want to guard against our fears. We don't want to get hurt, especially if it is relationships or intimacy. So we want to make sure that we're guarded. So any little thing that they do wrong, we want to be able to conclude it as somebody that will not be good for us. And I just feel like it does matter. But I think that for me, at least, you know, I've learned to, like, I have a rule, like I'll give you like four chances to see if my impression will change. But then, you know, before I used to talk myself into, no, it's okay. Maybe it's just me. Maybe what? And now I don't do that either. Like I don't do extreme anymore. So I just feel like, okay, let me try a couple of more times. And if they rub me off in the wrong way, I might not get close to them. They won't be my best friends, but they might just be, you know, acquaintance. I don't really push people away for, you know, cross them out unless I need to. But other than that, I'll just like, you know, try to understand where they are in my space. So the ones I don't like that much, but they might be good people in their own way. And then the people that I feel very comfortable, they become the closest to me. Because I just know our perception is our own. Nobody else's, you know, everyone has their own lens.
Oh, okay.
No, I mean,
No. We don't want.
With first impressions, do you think that maybe we also, like, because it is our own, you know, perception of something that's happening. So I'm wondering if it kind of goes into, like, we talk a lot about, like, how you asked, basically, how do you think people, you know, like, how do I think people perceive me, you know? And I wonder if we carry that into our first impressions too. So when you walk into a place, you already are walking in with this assumption that people think this about me, so this person might be thinking that. So I wonder if that also plays a role in our kind of how our first impression goes too.
Yeah, I think so. And I think, you know, it's like, you know, I know people, well, I mean, at least a lot of people have said you're intimidating, that I do, it depends on what group I'm with. And I do have to watch my soften up things. I don't, I'm not as assertive, aggressive, whatever that they think it is. I don't challenge as much on the first time or the second time, because I feel like people will, and it is, and maybe it's because I'm thinking that they're probably going to think that. But I do find myself a lot of time saying to myself, okay, Juliet, you know, just give this person a chance. Let's just figure out what they want. I don't judge right away anymore. maybe when I was younger, but now I don't. I just feel like, okay, let's just give them a chance. And then after a while, you're like, okay. Because I'm, you know, the same thing I said, like people would judge me and then they would miss out an opportunity with, I'm a really nice person. They're going to miss out that opportunity. I don't want to miss out on opportunity on someone that could be really a great person to be in my life.
So. Yeah. I like how you just emphasized, it's just boundaries, right? Of like how close you let that person in or where they sit sort of on your energy field. If they kind of rubbed you the wrong way, they're just a little bit further out. And if there's someone that, you know, you'd bring them in a little bit closer, but I like that.
Yeah. Yeah. Like I hardly ever like don't talk to someone that's it. Like I've met them. I mean, unless it's like, you know, a relationship or whatever where it was toxic. But other than that, when it comes to just friendship, I don't like dismiss people. I let them in, but I, you know, in, they are just playing different roles because there are a lot of people going to come into our life. They don't need to stay forever and some stay forever. So we'll see which ones they are. That's what I think.
Natty, how about you?
I mean, personally, I think like everyone always gets a second chance with me. You know, you like I give people a chance until they screw me over. And once you screw me over, I kind of write you off, you know, but I still continue to give people chances. I truly believe it's good to go through life not disliking anybody. You know, everyone has some type of value to offer, even if they are an absolute asshole. You know, I'm sure there's some value to offer and some lesson can be learned. Unless you're yelling at some poor guy at the grocery store, then I just want to punch you in the face. You know, like if I see someone doing that and then they come up and talk to me, I'm like, dude, you're a dick. Get out of my face. Yeah. That's just me. Or if you're like mean to a lady or a child, you know, like or an old woman, or if you don't like those little things, like those little tiny things, those set off my perception of someone and their ethics and values in life, especially towards other people and valuing other human life forms. I mean, that's where I kind of draw the line, you know.
Seeing somebody throw trash on the ground when the trash can is like 10 feet away. I hate that. Bad first impression.
So you don't like anyone in Kuwait now, do you, Meg?
Anybody walking along the marina that's throwing their trash on the ground, I hate you.
Well, especially considering there's literally trash cans like every other cement thing or whatever. I'm like, you walked in between, dropped it on the ground. If you took three steps, there's a trash can right there. I'm like, why? The cats love it though.
I love the fact that my 6-year-old son looks at me and says, Daddy, why are they just throwing their trash on the street? I'm like, DJ, people are rude and disrespectful and they have no value for, you know, their environment. And I want to say, DJ, look, when you grow up, you don't shit where you eat, buddy. You know, and that's a conversation that will be had later in life. But it's the truth, you know, like I learned that lesson from a cop, actually. When I was in my teens, you know, I was very, very disruptive, got into a lot of trouble. And we used to hang out at Dunkin' Donuts downtown Natick.
That doesn't surprise me at all.
Yeah.
Which one? Dunkin' Donut or
Dunkin' Donut? All of it. That surprises me.
That he was a disruptive child.
I know. I was going to say, which one? Yeah, you know. But I mean, there was one night we threw all our trash around our cars while we were hanging out. And this cop, who was an absolute asshole, but he gave me some value towards my life. He said, guys, just pick up your shit. You don't shit where you eat. And if you want to hang out here, that's fine. But just clean up after yourselves. And we all looked at each other and we could have said this guy's a dick and just gone, you know, been assholes. But me, Mark and Dave and Pat, we just kind of looked at each other and we're like, yeah, he's right. We're assholes. And we just got, we picked up our shit and we didn't do it again, you know, and I can't remember the cop's name, but he was an asshole.
I mean, you're still disruptive. So maybe that's one of your, maybe that.
That's his core value.
Getting kicked off of Instagram, just poking at the vegans just because. I mean,
he
tells people off all the time. Oh, that's our impression of you. We're already given the impression of you.
I was trying to steer this conversation.
You're trying before we got to him.
That's what he's trying to do.
Yeah. First impression. Yeah. Natty, actually. Okay. So the first time I actually saw you and I didn't realize it was you until after we had like the email conversation where I was being salesy. And after that,
I mean it in a good way. All right. I meant it in a good way. Like it was very,
it was funny. Cause like, okay. So the first time we actually like met was at the coffee shop to record our first podcast. Like there'd been some text conversation, you know, like before that, but I walked in and I was like, oh, that's Natty. I had seen you at the Borough working out before and you always had your piece of paper, your program, whatever you're doing. But I just remember thinking like, this guy like knows what he's doing. Like he's on his own. He's got his program. Like he's motivated. He's doing, like, it was just a different vibe of a person there. It was like, you didn't really talk to anybody. You just kind of went in, did your shit. And yeah, I just noticed that about you. And then your form was pretty decent on stuff. And I was like, okay. I'm like,
I leave it to you to say, yeah, he's got good form. So he's all right.
I was like, he's all right. I was like, it was very like,
I appreciate
very
that.
Bodybuilding, like bro kind of type stuff. And so it was a little bit of an eye roll inside with me, but then I was like, all right, he looks legit.
That's why she waited. She was like, okay, he's walking around this paper thinking he knows his shit. Let's see if he actually has good form. Oh, wait, he does. Damn it. Okay. Maybe he does actually know what he's doing.
Totally did. It was so funny. And then, yeah, comment in the Mind Pump forum from a guy in Kuwait. And I was like, what the hell? I'm in Kuwait. Let's connect. Buy my services. And then, yeah, it turned into the podcast. And I didn't realize it was you like that whole time. I was like, I've already had like three connections with this person. And I didn't realize it until I walked into the coffee shop. I was like, oh, shit.
Oh, that's funny. Yeah. That is funny. But no, I mean, the email you put together was well thought out. And you basically, you were the one who said like, yeah, don't worry, dude. You can like do all this shit again. And that's why, because doctors in Kuwait are fucked up. Like, they told me I couldn't lift weights again. I couldn't do this. So I went on to the forum freaking out because I know the Mind Pump forum, there's some smart people on there. And, you know, luckily enough smart people responded and they're like, dude, you got nothing to worry about, you know? And I was like, all right, sweet. I could go back to, you know, doing my thing again.
Oh man. I was like, wow, let me see what my person, I was going to, I don't want to use the word sarcastic, but
you can use whatever you want. It does not faze me one bit. You could say I'm an absolute asshole and I'm fine with that.
But it's in a fun way. Like our first, you know, kind of, you can like, you can take it too. So it's like, we can kind of rib each other on here and it's funny and we can make fun of it. And it's just like a fun, like it's not meant in any harm. And it's just, I don't know. It's just, it's kind of cool. It's nice to, you know, be able to, you know, kind of joke around with people and kind of have that kind of fun rapport, you know? Who doesn't like making fun of each other, right? In a good way. Positive, right?
I feel bad. Did I make fun of you?
You gotta laugh at the world.
I hope I didn't.
What? No, no. I just mean like, you know, like how we're giving you a hard time with the vegan
thing. I was joking about the soccer player thing, Jared, and the vegans, all right? Like, if you're vegan, it's cool, man. It's totally all right.
Oh my God. There's Mandy feeling bad.
No, I'm not saying to feel bad. I'm all about it. I say like, you know, you gotta laugh about stuff. You can't be too serious. It's just, you gotta laugh.
Yeah. So Dr. D, you gotta dig way back.
Yeah, dig way back. I can still remember like, you know, I thought in class, like, you know, I was thinking, oh my God, God help me with this kid. He's gonna need a lot of help. He's gonna come and kiss ass. Let me see what he wants. Like at first, I was like, you know, these students are like diplomatic and they give you compliments and they say how nice you are because they want to get an A.
Yeah, that's me. I try to work the program.
I was like, oh boy, this kid is going to take a lot of my energy. Let me figure this one out. And then he turned out to be the nicest student, very well, hardworking guy who like really cared about your grade. I still remember one time you came into my office trying to explain to you why I graded you on this.
Yeah, you gave me a C. I couldn't believe that. I worked my ass off.
Oh my God.
Yeah, I almost failed her class.
He harassed me. Why did you give me this? Why he was harassing me? I was like, should I just give this guy a grade just to get him off my back?
I thought you were. Like, I was shocked. I was like, I did a good job. You know, like, I suck at exams.
And I said, I said, no, you did not do a good job. No, you didn't follow these rules. And you're like, but I did. I tried, Dr. D. Doesn't that mean something to you? I said, no, it doesn't.
Trying's got to count for something. That's what I always used to say in school.
That's what he said.
I was like, trying's got to count for something. Like, look.
Like, yeah, exactly what he said to me. Doesn't trying? I said, no, it doesn't. You got to get the right answer. But then after that, it's like, I could see how sincere he was. And then, you know, when we talked a little more and I realized his brother had died and my brother had died, so I felt connected to him. You know, usually I don't tell my students anything about my past, and I felt like we connected. And ever since then, we've never like really stopped talking, you know. Sometimes some years we talk more than other years, but he's always been in my life for the last 10, 12 years. Jeez.
That's awesome.
Yeah, two people I haven't pissed off yet, Dr. D and Meg. I don't know how that one's worked out.
There's been annoyances, but not enough to write you off.
Hey, there's something wrong with you guys or something wrong with me. I don't know. Maybe I'm getting better.
That's
hilarious. But I always appreciate it. I mean, people might think of you. I mean, like, if I didn't really know you, I would think, oh, my God, you know, you are very sarcastic. But what I love about you is how much you don't care about what people think. Like, totally. You don't find that many people in Kuwait like that, that they're like constantly worried about what they're going to say. They calculate. You're one of the few people I know in Kuwait. They're like, I don't give a shit. I'm just going to say what I need to. You're very sincere. And I really admire that, to be honest. As much as honest and transparent I am, I don't think I'm as 100% like you are, seriously. Yes. And that I admire, actually.
Totally.
Yeah, you get an A for honesty.
Oh, thanks. I appreciate that.
The out of the norm of just like not giving a shit what people think. I think that's like a contagious energy that you kind of inspire and have. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Why care? I mean, let's be realistic. If people find you offensive, they're not going to, you know, they shouldn't follow you anyways or talk to you anyways. You know, if people can't relate to you and, you know, and enjoy the value that you bring to their life, whether it's through laughter or, you know, information through laughter or anything, or just being silly, you know, like we forget about being silly. You know, when we were kids, think of how much fun you had as a child, imagination, all that shit. And now it's kind of like stifled by being an adult. So I get pissed when my cousin's like, oh, you can't do that on Instagram. I'm like, I'll do whatever the fuck I want. I don't care. Yeah. If I want to wear a purple thong and run, you know, through my yard half naked, I'll do it.
Okay, so we know what the next bet is for Maddie. Careful what you say, Maddie.
I actually once lost a bet, and I had to wear an orange fishnet thong and run downtown Natick, or it was like down one of the streets in downtown Natick. Yeah, that was when I was like 17.
Back when the days, thank God there wasn't like Snapchat.
I know. No, there is a picture. There is a picture out there of me running around in an orange thong.
I'm dying to see that picture. I want to see.
We're going to find it.
I wonder what it would look like for Meg and I to be wearing a purple thong, and you are. And what would people say about us versus you?
Right.
That's a good point. I mean, what would they say about a guy running around in a purple thong versus a female running around in a purple thong? That would be a great experiment. No, seriously, on perception. I'm dead serious. What do you think perception would be on that? Like if they saw a 38-year-old guy in a purple thong running around, I mean, obviously they'd first probably call the cops, you know, most likely.
They would probably think like, oh, he's hilarious. He's got a sense of humor. He doesn't care what people think. Like what a, you know, crazy or like probably drunk or you know, like that.
I will be in jail.
Yeah. And then we would be called like,
exactly.
I don't think that's fair. That's not fair.
No.
Yeah. Not fair, but Meg and I will be in jail. And you would be the celebrity.
Yeah, I'd probably get on YouTube.
What are the first impressions you think other people have of you?
Oh, that I'm an asshole? Look, it's simple. You either love to hate me or you love me. In my opinion, like you either think I'm a loud, boisterous. I mean, if you ask Heya, she'll be like, oh, when I first met Mehdi, I was like, who's this loud, boisterous American guy? You know, just picking up a bench with three people on it. Like, that's what she thought. She thought I was an asshole. But in reality, when she got to know me, that I don't really care. You know, it was different. And that's what a lot of people, I think, once they get to know me, like, you meet me and it's either he's an asshole or I'll give this guy a chance. And like, you know, I understand him. So that's where it is. And honestly, it's, I don't know, man. I have no idea. I'm too erratic to figure it out.
Yeah, that's the thing about being like not caring what people think and being open and honest. So it's like at least people know where you stand, right? There's no question of like, what's this? Like, what's your motive? What's this guy after? Like, what? So if they think you're an asshole, like, cool, then the stance is clear.
Oh, that is true.
You know, so there's some benefits to that.
Like at the gym I'm at right now, they saw me train once and they're like, he's too serious, or like, you know, he's too hardcore for us. And in reality, like, I'm really not. Like, I have a guy that's the most unathletic person I've ever met in my life. And I'm just taking him through it step by step, real easy. And people still think I'm a hard ass. I'm like, dude, you know, whatever, man.
All right. We're going to do two more questions, one for connection and one for reflection. Okay. So for connection, if you have, when was the moment you realized you weren't invincible? Maddie hasn't realized it yet, so we can skip that. I'm just kidding.
That's a, I like that one. Kind of right on that one.
Still figuring it out. No. I think for me, it was probably traveling, like traveling alone for the first time. Like, I don't know, just wanting to be like really brave and then doing it. And you're like, holy shit, this is scary. Like, and just having to be aware of everything. I think there's a little bit of that for me. I have to think on that one a little bit more. It's a tough question.
That's a really tough question.
Yeah. The moment you realized you weren't invincible.
I was going to say maybe, I think it was shocking for me, maybe leaving, like getting out of a toxic relationship or deciding to make that decision and realizing like I was susceptible of being, you know, in a relationship like that, having never thought that I would have dealt with some of the shit that I dealt with, you know? So I think that kind of like hit me like, what? Like, I always thought like, hell no, I would never take that kind of garbage. And then I'm like, wow, you, well, now no judgment anymore. Yeah. Like you actually like.
Ooh, that one hits like, deep, Annika. Yeah.
I know. That's why I was like, well, yeah. If we're being completely honest here, I was like, I mean, yeah. It's not a positive invincible, but like, yeah. I definitely realized, I was like, all right, you got to really watch yourself and make sure you don't go down those paths. Totally. But yeah,
I was like, yeah. Totally. I would have to second that. Yeah. Toxic relationship of being like manipulated in so many ways where you're like, holy shit, how did I let this happen to me? And like just ignoring like red flag after red flag after red flag and like talking yourself out of things. And then like taking like, you know, Dr. B kind of pointed to this, they're like putting it on yourself of like, what am I doing wrong? You know, like kind of a thing. It's just that whole, yeah. Oh, that one hit deep, Danica. Thanks.
Throwing it out there.
That's very true. Yeah.
I was thinking the same thing as like, you know, always thinking that, no, this will never happen to me. I'm always in control. You know, I'm not going to be like these women who are going to be vulnerable. That will never happen to me. And it does happen to you. And when you are in whatever relationship it is, I mean, regardless if it's intimate relationship or friendship, that you feel like, especially for me, like, you know, I've studied human behavior. I should understand how behavior is. I should understand these like manipulative personalities, and then like, no, this will never happen to me. The other thing is that, you know, thinking that, oh no, you know, I'll never be heartbroken, or no, nothing will ever happen to me that is going to stop me from whatever, or the control that I have over, you know, something. And then I realized that that's not true, that, you know, that I can be out of control and things can go bad and things can affect me. So I'm not as strong as I think I am. You know, being in relationship that has like really taught me that, you know, you're not really as strong as you are, and that people can hurt you and that it can affect you. So yeah, I think relationships or toxic relationships, at least.
It's interesting about that too, is like thinking back to that time. And I don't know if this is true for you at all, Dr. D, but like I was working in behavioral health at the time, and I was working with a lot of people that were like bipolar and schizophrenic and all these things. And the relationship that I was in was 100% reflection of that. So it's like this idea, I don't know if I attracted that, of like, I can help somebody, you know, like with these issues. Like I didn't know that this person, you know, was dealing with that for a really long time, but I don't know if there's some of that just kind of like what attracts you, of like someone who kind of wanted like a caregiver or helper, like, and thinking that you could change somebody and help somebody in a way. And it's like totally being able to separate that of like, nope. Yeah. Okay. Like I can't take responsibility for you in that way. So that was something that definitely like was a reflection of the work that I was doing at that time. And like that young attitude, also being in your 20s, of just thinking like, I can help him. I can, I'll make him change.
You know, if you think about all these, like most of the time, like whenever I teach personality theory, my students always ask, why are all these theorists screwed up? And I said, why do you think they were in you know, in mental health? I believe, I mean, I'm not going to say 100%, but I feel like we get attracted into this field because we've got something that is, you know, that we don't have, or something that's missing, or a void that we're trying to fulfill, or we want to understand some of our traumatic experiences. And then we go into this field because we want to help other people, but we're technically trying to help ourselves.
Yeah.
And so, yeah. So this sense of like, you know, I'm never going to be depressed. I'm never going to, you know, ever reach this level. No, I will never be in a relationship where someone can abuse me mentally or physically. I know better than that. That's not true at all.
I wonder if too, at least for me, I think like falling into what that relationship and all those things. And like you were saying, you were working. I think it was kind of like a, I don't think I was happy about other things in my life when that started. So I think that was also part of it. So, and I'm just wondering, you know, and then I moved to Kuwait. So I was like, oh, bye.
That's it. Danica and I both did
halfway around the world
to move to Kuwait. That was like, there was like many of Kuwait was like the halfway house for like the 20 something like toxic relationships. Yeah. We all got there and we're like, yeah, no men. We're great all on our own. Like,
yeah. I mean, I will never forget. I remember exactly where I was, exactly what I was doing. I was miserable. I was pissed off. I was living with this person. And like, I get this text from my cousin Diego, hey, would you move to Kuwait? And I was like, yes. And he's like, let's do, before I even had interview anything. I mean, literally, I just had that text message, little like few conversations. I got up the next day. I went into work. I put my 2 weeks notice in. I bought my plane home. I bought the thing to ship my car home, went home. And I said, I'm leaving in 2 weeks. That was that. Wow. The decision was made. And I was like, once I make a decision, it's quick. It's like, awesome. All right, we're going forward. But, you know, sometimes it takes a little while to get there. But yeah, I was like, whew.
That is awesome.
So, so now my friends give me a hard. They're like, yeah, you. I was like, that relationship must have been bad because you moved halfway across the world to get there. I was like, sometimes you just got to.
I like this idea. Kuwait being a halfway house.
There's a handful of us.
But if you think about it, it's true. I mean, I was married at that time, but still, like, you ever think about it, like, why? I mean, I'm born in Kuwait and I have some roots here, but still, like, I felt like, why did I come back? And I think it is. I was like, at that time in my life, I was wanting to make a change. I was a new mom and, you know, my marriage already wasn't going well. I thought I got to leave the family, leave his family, try to be able to come here and make a life of our own where we can depend on each other and grow together. That didn't go very well, but at least we started. But I lasted longer being married here, I think, if I would have stayed in the US. So yeah. I think maybe you're right. I think we all needed a new place so we can start new. And maybe that's a lot of times why expats come to these places sometimes.
Yeah. I just think y'all are fucking crazy.
There's a lot of that where we always question. We're like, what's wrong with us?
It's like, you go to like Dubai, but you come to Kuwait. Like, what's the deal with that, man? You know, but Kuwait makes sense. Look, Kuwait does make sense for someone who wants to save money, right? Travel the world. Like, you can do all that here. You legitimately can do all of that.
That's true.
Yeah.
And you can leave your mom and family behind. I mean, you know, there's a lot of people that also are not connected to their family. The extended family is very dramatic. You can come here. You don't have to deal with that drama. There's so many stories of why people come here. I mean, besides that, yes, we make good money. We can travel. But it also keeps you away from people that are dramatic. Like, I can't do drama anymore. Seriously. No more drama in my life.
You're a psychologist. Like, you got drama every day. Like,
exactly.
Like, you pick the one profession where you're going to get that shit every day.
So if I have drama because I'm paid to hear the drama, I can't live with drama. I cannot handle family members who are dramatic. I can't handle friends who are dramatic. I don't. You know, I don't need to. So I can't do drama anymore. Mm-hmm. So that's one thing. Thanks to Kuwait, they taught me to stay away. What about you, Mahdi?
Yeah, again, I was trying to avoid this one. No, mine was...
You was trying to avoid.
I don't really like talking about, you know, these things, but, you know, it's time to open up and, you know, like, you know, express myself and shit, you know, especially on the show because we talk about that a lot. Mine was actually quite recent. It was a couple of weeks ago where I don't usually get depressed and bogged down. And it was a struggle for me. I don't know what sort of triggered it. I think part of it was just overtraining. You know, I think I was definitely overtraining at the time. And that could really mess with your hormones and mess with your psyche. And then your body starts to break down. And being my age, and when you don't manage your training volume well or your intensity well, it bites you in the ass. And I think that was creeping up on me. I wanted to feel younger at one point. So I went into a throwdown, which was not the smartest thing I should have done. And, you know, and then the reality set in of I'm competing with 20-year-olds who, you know, like I had my first girlfriend when they were born, you know, like, and now I'm trying to compete with a 20-year-old in a wad that he's going to wipe the floor with me. And to be fair, like I was happy I held my own in some of them, but it was just like, I just went through this bout of, you know, being depressed and I never really go that route. And I've never really kind of been in those dark places in my life. And Luckily, I am the type of person that I can dig myself out of that hole and just be like, you know, I can work through it. I can do the self-talk thing and I can really, you know, talk myself up of look at what you've accomplished. Look at where you are at your age. Okay, yes, you're an aging athlete, but there is beauty in being an aging athlete. And then I watched the talk that Ben Bergeron gave on CrossFit athletes who are, you know, in the master's category. And it changed my perception of every 5 years, guess what? I'm the youngest athlete in that pool. So now I'm in the mindset of, you know what? Okay, fuck my 35 to 40. Let's think of 40 to 45, 45 to 50, 50 to 55. Let's go that far and see how far I can get because I love to compete. And the day that that's taken away from me is going to break my heart. And, you know, I don't want to live vicariously through my son either. So it's just, you know, depression is a tough thing and it's a real thing that some of the strongest people go through. I went through it, and a lot of people that I know in my social circles think I'm one of the strongest guys mentally. You know, that quit point isn't there. And, you know, there were times I went out to work out and I couldn't feel it. I took a week off. You know, I definitely took a week off and I had to recalibrate, reset, find my passion again, find my drive. And, you know, luckily it happened. And even going back was tough to pick up a barbell the first time. But then it was small steps forward, you know, small steps and small little wins. And every time I had a little win, I fucking celebrated the fuck out of it.
Yeah.
Because I wanted to be sure to, because I knew that that small win would lead to a bigger win. And right now, you know, the ball's rolling, the open's coming around for my age group. And, you know, hopefully I'll do well and move up 1,000 spots. I'm not trying to get into the top 1,000, just trying to move up 1,000 spots. That's it. You know, like one small thing at a time. So yeah, I was depressed. Fucking sucks, but you get through it. You know, Dr. D helped me through it a little bit. I talked to her. So sorry. Hope I didn't ramble.
So you thought you're never going to be depressed?
No, that's like, that's huge. And I think that's big, like celebrating the small. I've recently gotten back into like weightlifting as well. And it's like a huge check to the ego. And also like, yeah, trying not to get like so down on yourself, but also like, I mean, obviously reaching out to and knowing just who your support system is and who you can get help from and like trying to take it all on your own is obviously kind of helps. It just makes you like spiral even deeper sometimes into some of those negative thoughts. So yeah, you touched on a lot. That's good.
It's hard. I think that's why now I've kind of like changed how I view things instead of, because I found myself kind of doing the same thing where I'm just like, oh, like how, like, why am I not, I'm not as good as I was before. I'm not this as good at, you know, and this isn't working at all. And I'm like, you know what? Or why did I eat junk food for a month? Like, look where you are now, like constantly like putting myself. And then I was kind of like, okay, no matter where you're at, instead of reflecting back on why didn't I do this then? It's like, okay, well, you can't change the past. So, you know, a deep breath, give yourself that, you know, for me, it's like, give myself that one, you know, moment of being like upset about it. And then just for me, it's like, create the action plan of, okay, what can I do starting today to change moving forward? As opposed to like, cause I, you know, I think we all do that. We get caught up in that, the negative side of it, and you just can't stop thinking about the negative. And then you obsess over that negative and it just causes you so much stress and you're down. And then it's like, it can be hard to like find your way back up, you know? So, I mean, not that I do it all the time, but that's kind of what I try and do now. And then just writing the action or like thinking of the action plan already makes me feel better. Cause I'm like, okay, at least I'm working towards something again or going, getting towards where I was before, you know, as close as I can or, you know, whatever it is.
100%. Dude, it started for me. The ice baths helped.
Yeah.
I don't know why, but Meg, you know how I told you I never could meditate?
Yeah.
I hit this meditative state a couple days ago when I was in an ice bath and I had never been so deep in thought. I thought it was the greatest thing in the world. And it almost felt like my body was just sinking through the ground. I was so deep in thought. And it was just like, I was in this ice bath, you know, this 50 degree water, 47 degree water. And I didn't want to get out. It was, I was in there for a good 16, 17 minutes. And I had only realized the water was trembling because I was, you know, I was fucking cold. I was shaking.
Yeah.
So, you know, I got out of it and I went in the sauna and I was shivering and my teeth are chattering. And I'm like, oh my God, I think I finally experienced meditation. And it's helped with my recovery since. And it's just been, little things, you know, like Danica said, I've been making little small things that I've changed in my daily routines, like adding, you know, collagen, adding, and this goes back to conversations we've had, Meg, where you said add something in rather than removing something. And, you know, I'm just adding things in that hopefully help, you know, and it's recovery too. So, I mean, getting better. It's getting better. I don't have to go see Dr. D yet.
I love that. It's funny. Like, Maddie, yeah, if there's one thing I think that you could like add more of to your life? I would say like some meditation, like getting yourself into that like meditative state to just decompress in that way. And it reminds me of like Danica and I kind of learned meditation process like in the same time, like when we were starting the yoga studio with Circuit Plus. And I just remember it being so funny, like getting out of those sessions and Danica's like, I just hate it when they tell me to be present. Like, where the hell else would I be? Like, I'm right here in class.
Literally, they're like, be present, be on your mat. And I'm like, I'm in this uncomfortable yin yoga position for like 2 minutes already. I know exactly where the hell I am right now. I am here and that's the problem. I'm like, oh my gosh. Yeah, so I would leave. I'd be like, oh, I'm grounded. I'm here. I feel this mat.
Hating it, can't think of it. Therapy though, Maddie, I will say like those mornings where I get the hot springs and the cold river back and forth, that's a drastic shift in energy. It's something that I think cold blast in the shower, you don't have to spend 16 minutes in there. It sounds like either you hit meditation or you're starting to hit hypothermia. I don't know.
I think I was hitting hypothermia. I mean, I don't know.
Even if it's just like a cold blast, like 30 seconds, like just give it a try. It's like a huge shift in energy.
It wakes you up. DJ calls it a cup of coffee. Like he's like, yeah, daddy, I want a cup of coffee. Cool. And it truly does feel like a cup of coffee. It heightens my senses. Like, and I think everybody's different, but for me, it's like,
it's interesting how it works because it's great in the morning. It does wake you up, but I also do it before bed. And part of it gets you ready for a deep sleep because it lowers your core body temperature and it stimulates some deep breathing. So it actually helps you fall asleep faster too. So it's really interesting how it works.
I do it after workouts and it's typically 2 hours before bed and I sleep like a freaking baby, like no CBD, no nothing. Like I just sleep right through the night and it's awesome.
All right. Okay. Level 3, we've made it. Reflection.
Ooh. We've made it to reflection. No one's cried. No one's gotten mad yet. No one hung up on the Zoom meeting. All right, listeners, this is something y'all can try with your friends and family. Okay. This is now project approved.
Project approved.
It could also be good for people that want to get rid of other friends is play this game and then you won't be friends anymore.
Exactly.
You needed a reason to get rid of this person. This is the game for you.
So funny.
But I kind of like this, really. We should do it more often. I like this interaction.
All right, Maddie, I've got 4 cards up. Pick 1, 2, 3, or 4.
3.
What do you think my defining characteristic is?
That is a deep question. That is so insanely deep. All right, Dr. D, you're first.
Oh, no.
You're a psychologist. You know, I'm sure you've thought about this before.
Not with Meg. You know her. You go. You can't escape like this so quick.
No, you go. It's your turn to go first.
Your turn.
What's your deep defining characteristic?
I don't know.
Is it as a mom? Like, you're a strong mom. Like, stuff like that.
Go ahead, Maddie. Continue.
All right, the game show is going to shift over to Danica. You're up first.
Nobody wants to answer first.
I like to avoid, so it's Danica. You're up.
Yeah, I know. You're doing a good job.
Awesome.
I think we know your defining characteristic already.
Avoidance.
All right. I was going to say, I think caring, like when you care about something or like you want to teach other people the same thing, like you want to better people. And I just feel like that just shows like truly caring, you know, and especially like whether it's like you said, from doing like workshops you're doing to like what you do in your work and, you know, coaching, it just, you remember, like when people tell you things, you remember that because you're like actively listening and you really care about that person and you really do want to help. And I just think that sometimes it's kind of hard to find that nowadays, that like nice, like kind of that people who really actually do care.
Aww.
Good point. Yeah, that's good, Danica. Wow. I should start talking to you instead of Dr. D. At least you care.
You sell me out so quickly, my God.
Replacing Dr. D is Dr. Danica.
I know, right? Oh, it's another Dr. D. It's all good.
That's hilarious.
I would say passionate, too, I think. Well, there was a couple of times we did an episode and you were like, you know, maybe it was a time that there was Black Lives Matter or riots. I can't remember what it was actually, but it was one of those like chaotic time in the US. Yeah. It's the first time I've seen you like, you know, very passionate about what was going on or like how much it was affecting you. Or so I feel like, I guess it goes to what Dianca's saying is that you do. It seems like what I enjoy about you is that you're really, you know, you're committed to whatever it is that you're doing. That's a nice defining character, that you do have sense of commitment and You don't sell people out like Maddie does.
I just redid my my core values. I haven't redone them in a while. And commitment was one of them that came up for me. So that's like awesome to hear. And I've asked other people before, like what they think my superpowers are. And I've heard like listening is one that comes up. So it's just like really cool to hear this from you guys too. It's just sort of empowers me a little bit more to lean into that. That's awesome. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, Maddie.
100%. I mean, I totally agree with Dr. D and Danica. Yeah.
I love that we're like 100%. Come on.
Give I'm going to have a t-shirt that says 100% on the back. That's like my new saying. No, but yeah, like 100%, dude. Like very caring and just understanding.
Thank you, guys. I appreciate that. All right. Who's next, Maddie? Who's on deck?
Dr. D.
I have none.
I was going to say confidence.
Yeah.
Yeah. Definitely. Confidence.
I agree with that. Totally.
Confidence. Your laugh is also something that's like very like specific and contagious. I love that. But I would say, confidence and in conviction and like what you're saying. Yeah. I like that.
I definitely say determination, determination and telling people what's up. Like you're not afraid to friggin' lay down the law to anybody. And I love that about you. Like, it's like, you know, you're very, very upfront and you could be really, really passionate. Well, I don't want to say mean, but passionate, you know, not you're not aggressive in the bad way, but you can really define your thoughts and your processes to a person to make them get what they need to get done. And I've known that about you for years, and I appreciate that. And I think that's something I've learned from you. And to me, that's a definition of you, is like the drive to just get it done.
Yeah. We call that the velvet hammer. Knows how to lay down the velvet hammer.
Velvet hammer.
Yes, compassion, but it's like, yo, this is it. Like, but it's in a compassionate way. Yeah.
All
right. Can I please start with Danica? Just be nice. I think you're just the nicest person in the room. And like, you'll never say no.
I thought he was going to totally burn you.
Waiting. And I was like, I'm ready.
No, seriously. Like you were talking about that earlier. You're like, yeah, people always think I'm nice. But no, you come off as a very nice person. And like, at first I was like, who the fuck's stealing my podcasting spot? And I was like, oh, she's so cool. She's awesome. Like, it's all right. It's all good. You can steal my podcast spot with Meg. It's cool. You know, it's all good.
It's hard to hate the nice guy, you know, you just can't. Wow. Yeah. I don't know. Interesting.
But
yeah.
Determined, I think determined could be one of them also, your defining characteristic. Just the idea of the story that you said, and, you know, once you make a decision and that's it, like how painful, no matter how painful that decision was that you made, and I'm sure you've made other ones, is that you take it and you decide that to make the best of it. So I think this, you do have that sense of determination also.
I think for me with Danica, it's, you're so grounded. You're just so like, you are in a lot of ways of like, she's so good at looking at both sides of things that I know that like, if I need to talk to her about something or just like get her perspective on things, it's just really just balanced, I guess, is the best way of like, she's really good at playing like the devil's advocate on both sides. And I really appreciate that because it kind of checks like, you know, just where you're slipping and maybe like, you know, falling into a closed box of something. So I just feel like she's always good at like pointing out of like, well, like, you know, it could be this, and like, you like love it and hate it at the same time. You're like, shut up. I know. I don't want to think about them like having that perspective or that like being the thing. But then other times you're like, damn it, I'm really glad she brought that up.
I was going to say, I was like, that one definitely gets me in trouble for sure. Like, I just wanted to vent. Like, why are you defending them? And I'm like, just trying to throw it out there. There might be the other sides to this.
On the management
team, too, at work.
Yeah. On the management team, we used to call her Switzerland.
Oh, geez.
Like, so impartial.
Sometimes you just kind of, and there are also just some battles you just don't want to deal with. You're like, yeah, and just you guys go ahead and yell at each other about that one. I'll sit over here.
Dude, on a side note, I can't believe that Kuwaiti Gym started with people like you and they've ended up with people like this, what's going on in Kuwait right now. Like, I can't believe we've taken that shift. It's kind of like Dr. D, no offense, education. You know, like, it started off really well. And then we kind of got, like, the abusive teachers. And now we got the teachers that can't really teach anymore in the United States because they've broken so many laws. They were shifted to Kuwait. And I kind of feel like that's what's happened with like trainers and management and gyms, that it's kind of like the trainer that got sued in, you know, the UK or US, and now they just ended up in Kuwait for life. You know,
so. Off the grid.
I know, right?
That's why you're really trying to convince us to come back.
I know, dude.
Yeah.
Do you want to hear something crazy? One of my friends called me up today and he goes, dude, is 35 KD for a PT session? Is that a good price? And I'm like, are you fucking insane to pay 35 KD for a PT? Like, what are they doing for you in this PT? I mean, no offense, but
I'm sorry. They have to massage me also.
Right? Yeah.
Like, in my house.
It's possible.
Are they serious? 35?
Yeah, 35 KD. Like,
who's paying that?
I don't know.
I had clients that paid me that. That was the start of my package. Depending on how many sessions you bought with me, the lowest I would go is to 25. But I had people paying 35. I had people paying 40 KD for individual sessions at one point.
Wow.
But how long is it? An hour? Hour and a half?
Hour.
Wow, I think that's really hefty right now.
Just out of curiosity, like, what'd you do? Like, I honestly, I told my buddy, I was like, dude, they ain't a Hollywood trainer. What are they offering you? Like,
a lot of the times those sessions were very like specific, right? It wasn't like a long-term, like the ongoing ones. Like, I didn't charge my people that I saw like weekly. Like, that was usually a bigger package or something. But if it was like something very specific that they wanted to go after and get out, and it was like an intensive session, like set up with, you know, a huge like success plan, like come back to me in like 6 weeks, 12 weeks or something. And we can like dive in at the next point. So it was more of like a bigger investment at that point, like people that were a little bit more self-sufficient with stuff and didn't need, I guess, like the handholding every week or that kind of accountability. So it was usually like athletes, someone who's working on some mobility, something. And it's like, great, here's what you're going to do for the next 6 weeks. Come back and see me and I'll know if you've been doing it or not.
Yeah.
Like, you know, like where things are going. So it was a lot of that. And then there was some of it was like the mindset stuff. So some of it was like the self-leadership stuff that I had gone through. And it was like figuring out, you know, how to deal with like tough boundaries and like setting up that kind of stuff. And so it was like an intensive of like coaching of just like, what are you dealing with? What do you need some coaching around? Like what kind of, and it was mostly me just like asking questions and kind of helping them come around to their own solution of like what really needed to be done. But it was just being that person who's outside of the situation to ask the questions to get them to like really understand. Like I didn't hash into people's like past or like not like what a therapist would do or anything like that. It was very like coaching of like forward focused and future focused of like, this is what you're struggling with. And I would just be able to give them the tools and ask the questions to kind of help them handle the situation.
Probably matters. Like if you're talking about someone just going in to have a one-on-one workout session with and be coached during it.
Yeah.
To me, yeah, maybe 35, 40 KD is, well, it's a little crazy for something
steep,
like that.
Right, for a PT.
But if you're looking for something specialized, okay, so like, let's say like I actually need like corrective work. So like,
I would agree with that. Yeah, I would agree.
You know, I busted my knee and I need these specific, that I understand you want to pay more for that. And yeah. I do think there is value. Now, if you're just, you know, Joe Schmo on your phone being like, okay, you're going to do 3 sets of 10 chest presses and be over here, I would not pay. Don't pay for that.
But that's it. It was for a PT for a female who wants to like lose weight, tone up and whatever. And I was like, dude, 35 KD, like for a PT, that's, you know, that's kind of highway robbery. Like,
yeah,
I mean, Dr. D, I think you're in the wrong profession at this point. Like, how much
that's
do
what
you
I was
charge?
Thinking. I was
like what
you know?
Do they charge at the clinics in Kuwait? I'm curious.
I mean, some of them do charge 35. Can you imagine with a master's? I mean, of course, we're doctorate level. So our price is about online is 50 and the office is like 60 or 65. Now we do have packages and they can have some of those to help them out. But I feel like a lot of times people are just like overpriced. I mean, look, I shouldn't have said right away because if they're going to charge me 35 and they're certified in many things with PT, they do special, you know, like you said, corrective. Like, and if I would pay that, I would also pay that. If I know I'm just getting one session, very in-depth, kind of a, you know, that it will, you know, give me whatever I need. And then I see you again once a month. But that thing, that's hefty to be paying once a week.
She said she could only do twice a week and it was 35 KD per session.
Wow.
I was like, wait, shit. I was like, just I'll charge her 25 KD for online. How about that? I'll just write your program. I'll watch you via phone.
I told my friend, I said what you said, Meg. Basically what you guys said. I said, look, doctors charge like 20 KD to go to like, you know, a private clinic.
Or 35.
Yeah, it costs 20 or 35 KD to go to a doctor.
Yeah.
Now you're talking about paying someone 35 KD to give you a sweat session.
Yeah.
I was like, dude, I'll give it to you for free. That's just stupid. If you want to spend that much, I can point you in the right direction to a really good trainer, you know, like, you know, an Edwin or a Vincent, one of those guys. And it's like, you're paying 15 KD less. And I was like, don't pay that. All you're going to do is drive the market up and give these guys here more of an ego than they already have. You know, I mean, let's be realistic.
Well, and it is defining what, because obviously, yes, you can compare it and say, well, you could go to a private, you know, doctor and see this for this amount. And then, or you can go to the gym and do this PT, since the value also is on the individual. So I think like,
good
if
point.
I value this more, then of course I'm willing to pay upwards of whatever, because this is what I actually want. But I think a lot of people, especially when it comes to, I mean, it's like with anything. So whether you're going to go talk to someone or you're, you know, going for a PT session, those things are very, you know, people are intimidated, you know, you're a little shy. It's something new. And I find that what happens too is a lot of people go in, they finally get the courage to go in, ask people about these PT sessions. They get a number. They just say, okay, I'm just going to do it. But what really you should do like one session with multiple trainers.
Yeah.
Because 100%. I think a lot of people don't shop around. They just get comfortable with this one person. And then you actually don't know. You might be able to pay 35 KD and get 90 minute sessions with a whole bunch of stuff with someone else, you know? And I think that that's kind of the issue, is people just get recommended from one person and they just continually go to that, you know, trainer or that whoever it is, and they never shop around. So you might be like, I don't know. I think that's part of it too. Like, I would encourage people to visit more than one personal trainer, you know, go outside and just kind of check it out a little bit more, because there might be someone that you connect with more that even if you're paying the same price, you're probably going to get better results out of it. So
like, well, I think there's also that, like that trip up of looking at somebody and seeing how they move and what they can do. And that person, you know, like has the body and they can do the things, right? So they're like, oh, I can change. Like, that doesn't mean that they're a good coach. And we've talked about this before. Like, just because they can demo how to do something doesn't mean that they know how to coach you through it or that they can get you to be a good coach. So I think sometimes it's also that image. I mean, we know how important image is in Kuwait. And we've talked a little bit about this earlier. It's, you know, so I think people looking at that and being like, oh yeah, that person must know what they're doing because their body looks so great, or, you know, whatever. So I'm just going to pay them whatever, you know, I've got the best trainer because they look the best. And it's like, nope, that might not be it.
Unfortunately, sometimes when you look the best, you're actually the most unhealthy. So
I know that. Yeah. That's so
look
true.
Look the best, like what people think is the best.
Danica, you brought up a good point. See, I would pay 35 KD for a 90 minute session with someone that would work on my movement and work on, you know, certain specific things. I would pay that premium price for the premium added things. Now, I've been doing this for long enough where I could tell someone's full of shit when it comes to, you know, certain things. And there are a lot of snake oil salesmen here, you know, especially with the nice bodies. I mean, you know, I think we can all agree on that. And Dr. D, in your profession too, like, I'm sure there are a lot of psychologists here in Kuwait where you just kind of roll your eyes and you're like, are you shitting me? You know, who the hell gave this asshole his degree and where did he get it from? And it's even within fitness right now. And I'm seeing it a lot where people are coming out with, you know, they're calling themselves doctor.
Yeah.
And then you look, when you dive deep into where they're from, where they graduated from, and it's like they got their degree from, you know, like a country where you're not, where it's not really credible. You're like, dude, really, man? Like, yeah, you can buy a teacher off with a pen over there, you know? So it's like, it's tough.
No, it's true. And you see that a lot in my field. And also charging 100, 120 for a psychologist. What are you talking about? Like, that's totally overrated. And for what? I mean, you know, one of my friends was saying to me the other day there, he was saying that, you know, if you look at all the psychologists and psychiatrists in Saudi, and they're very well trained and they've got like really, really good mental health providers, and their prices is like half of what we provide here. We are so overpriced in Kuwait. It's ridiculous. And people can't access services because we're so expensive. Like, you know, I don't understand. And even if you look at their experience or even their degrees or what qualifies someone to be able to offer 80 KD or 90 KD for a session, what are they talking about for 50 minutes? I feel, but you're right. I think a lot of times it has also something to do with like who recommended that coach, who recommended that doctor. Oh yeah, my friend, you know, she's VIP. She's seeing this person. I have to see that person. You know how Kuwait is. Mm-hmm. A lot of times people are seeing other people because someone recommended them that they were also, they were VIP or they were important person or whatever. Or even like, you know, your friend is seeing so-and-so, you go because of the word of mouth. And then they're like stuck with this person instead of shopping around. I'm always surprised that people don't get second and third opinion. They should do that. In my field, it's very important because you need to be comfortable with that person. It's a relationship. I have to like you. You have to like me. It's not just my client liking me. I have to like them also. I have a say in this. And they should be able to shop around and see. There are people that charge, you know, 50 or 40 and they're really good, you know. Here, no, you see, oh, he's charging 100, so he must be better. That's nothing to do with being better because you're charging more. But unfortunately, right. You've got that mentality here. Well, you know, so-and-so is charging 80. They must be more expensive, means they're better, and they're not.
One more question, really important one before we, you know, we end this thing. And I think you're all going to, Meg, I think you're going to like this. I think you're all going to like this question. And it's been driving me fucking crazy for the past 3 weeks.
Oh, God.
And I say that with complete passion and conviction, and I'll probably get banned from Instagram sooner or later. But what do you guys think of all of these professionals, whether they're a psychologist, a doctor, a fucking trainer, whoever, especially trainers, because this eats me up inside because I fucking gave my life for 15 years coaching baseball for free, doing community service, and these sons of bitches don't do shit for the youth growing up in this country. We have some of the fattest kids in the world, and they're doing shit. They're not getting in the parks. They're not saying, I'll give free PT sessions. Son of a bitch, get out there. We're paying people this much money. Where is the community service? Where is the value for the community and everyone around you? I've said my piece. Thank you. Drop the mic.
Well, that was a good way to end this, actually. You're right.
Sorry, guys.
I think people are not. Even in my field, they're not doing pro bono as much.
You used to do that. I mean, you always did it in school. That's how we met. It was doing pro bono.
I always do that. And no, and I still do it. But the thing, this is what I'm saying. I think you're right. I think more people are becoming much more focused on making money. They're not focused on community service or mentorship or anything like that. And that's unfortunate, especially now, like, you know, a lot more people need help and a lot more people, they're not making as much money or they don't have a job or, you know, yeah. Community service. I don't think it's a word that has been mentioned a lot. People don't do a lot of community service.
Yeah. It goes back to, I think like laws of attraction in a way, mm-hmm. right? Like I think people are afraid to give things away because, you know, whatever their financial situation and whatnot. But I think when you put that kind of energy out there of like giving a service, right? Helping people out. Like, I think that you can, I believe in that kind of stuff. And I think that it'll come back to you in some way. I think that whatever you can give and provide, like whether that's monetary value to something, to a good cause, if it's your skill and your service and your strength, like make time for that, make room for that and put that out there. And I think that that will only help, you know, your business or whatever service you're trying to provide. I think it'll only help that grow if you're willing to support and put that out there too. I think there's nothing wrong with giving some stuff away.
I think people are worried about devaluing themselves or devaluing what they have.
It's community service. It's giving back.
The problem is once you give something away for free in any way, shape or form, they're just going to keep scratching. They're just going to keep going for more and more and more and more and more. And it's like, I think for a lot of people, it's when do I draw that line of, you know, okay, I gave this for free, but do you just have to like draw a boundary for it? Is there, and I think in Kuwait,
that's it. Yeah.
Yeah. So I
look,
think
everything is not black and white.
Yeah.
I think it's being clear. I give my time for free to this community service and this is what I do for free. Like if you want to work with me in this capacity, here's what that looks like. I think it's just being also very clear in what you communicate. Yeah.
I mean, I think for us is like, you know, I feel like for me, it's like, I don't have to say that I'm pro bono for all these, but there are special people that come in and say, I really need your help, but I can't afford it. I give them a sliding scale. I do believe that people should contribute something better than nothing. But even if they contribute 5 kg, for example, for their session, it's much better than doing it for free, because I agree with you, Dianca, is that they do take advantage of that. But I feel like, you know, we have to take it by, I'm not going to do it for everyone, but there are certain places or certain shelters or certain things I stand for that I'm willing. But if someone comes to me and says, look, I don't really have money, but I'm very depressed, I'm suicidal. it is my duty to give them something. They offer them, even if it's one session or two where they can just talk to me or even text me where I can help just listen to them. I think that it's important for my values.
What about on an organized scale? I mean, for instance, baseball coaching. Like, I was a coach for 15 years. I never got paid by the league, nothing. And they knew the boundaries with me. You know, I would coach one team, two practices a week, plus a game, whatever. I didn't do umpiring. I didn't commit to what I couldn't do. And I always made that very clear. But at the same time, I know I gave my service, you know, and I appreciated the time spent. And I think that that gave me confidence as a person, that built my characteristics. And it gave, you know, like, I'm going to go to the grave knowing I gave back something to society. And there's value in that and value in choosing a coach that does, you know, it could be the smallest thing, like a 15-minute session with, you know, going into a fifth grade class. You know what I mean? Like going into a school and giving a talk on health and wellness or movement or whatever it is as the coaches here in the society. And kids look up to these, you know, trainers that have big guns and whatever. And to me, it's just like, I don't see it in the training field, especially here in Kuwait. I don't see it in Kuwait in general, like even from big companies.
Here's the other side of that. As far as like the training community goes, I mean, at least when I was there, I would say the training community was mostly expats. So is it that we should be relying on necessarily the training group, or how about the people who own these facilities that are locals?
Yeah.
They should be holding, you know, people in government accountable and maybe pushing for programs and maybe providing, saying, hey, why don't I have some of my trainers go to these schools and I will volunteer their time and I will have them do these talks, or I will. So to me, it's like, do we need to rely on necessarily like every individual trainer, or should it be that the people that are, you know, basically the business owners in the community that should care about this stuff? Because I mean, the more you educate the children, probably the more the parents are also going to get educated, and you're probably going to get more business that way on top of it. So it's just surprising to me that, you know, we people who are local there, who do own these places, you know, maybe that's where the pressure should really be, is pushing them to say, hey, you should be giving back to your community. This is something you're passionate about. Use these trainers and do that. Like, why don't we do that? Like, that's kind of how I would see it too.
I love that. And I think we should end it there and pick this conversation up in a full episode so we can totally rip on these assholes.
We're gonna meet again and play this.
Love it. That was fun, guys.
That was a lot of fun.
That was very much. Yeah, I loved it. At first I was like, oh, play a game. I'm so serious. I don't do these. And these guys are younger. And I was thinking, these guys are younger than me. They probably have more information about this stuff. Well, it was fun. See? Perception.
Yeah. There you go.
Thanks, guys, for listening to us.
Bye, guys.
Thanks for listening to this episode. If you enjoyed it, please head over to iTunes to subscribe, rate, and leave a review. You can also find us on Instagram @ProjectThankYou and join us next time.